Right now, as you watch this video, 17 classified payloads circle the moon in darkness, their purposes hidden behind walls of military secrecy. Imagine sitting at a chessboard where your opponent's pieces shimmer in and out of existence, where every move echoes across 384,000 kilometers of vacuum, and where the prize isn't just checkmate. It's the economic and military high ground for the next 1,000 years. In the eternal silence above our heads, nations are playing a game that will determine whether your grandchildren vacation on the moon or watch it from Earth. Divided into territorial zones, they'll never touch. Welcome to humanity's shadow war for lunar control, where tomorrow's history is being written in thrust vectors and treaty clauses, in permanently shadowed craters and classified satellite maneuvers. The starting gun fired at 2:26 UTC on January 3, 2019, but nobody heard it. As most of humanity slept, China's Chang'e 4 spacecraft descended through the vacuum toward Von Karman crater. For 14 minutes, its engines fought lunar gravity while Earth's most powerful radio telescope strained to hear. Nothing. The spacecraft had vanished behind the moon itself, entering the far side. That mysterious hemisphere eternally turned away from human eyes. Then, like a heartbeat returning after cardiac arrest, the signal returned. Not from the lander, but from Queqiao, a relay satellite China had secretly positioned at the Earth-Moon L2 Lagrange point 6 months earlier. Imagine a cosmic parking spot where Earth's and Moon's gravity perfectly balance, allowing a spacecraft to hover with minimal fuel. China hadn't just landed on the Moon's hidden face, they'd installed a permanent watchtower. Think of it this way. If the Moon were a fortress, China had just placed a guard in the one tower that overlooks the back gate. The gate Earth can never see. Within 72 hours of Chang'e 4's landing, emergency meetings convened in the Pentagon. Within weeks, the Trump administration accelerated NASA's timeline. The Artemis program, announced with unusual urgency, compressed a 15-year plan into 5, later adjusted to 8 when reality collided with ambition. The official reason: maintaining American leadership in space. The classified briefings told a different story. China now possessed exclusive real-time surveillance over half the moon. But surveillance was just the opening move. The real game began with competing rulebooks. On October 13, 2020, as COVID ravaged Earth, the United States quietly gathered 7 nations to sign the Artemis Accords. These weren't treaties. Treaties require Senate approval. These were agreements that established something called safety zones around lunar landing sites. Imagine claiming you don't own the beach, but you do control a safety zone, extending exactly as far as the valuable beachfront property. As of today, 56 nations have signed these accords, creating the Western bloc's legal framework for carving up the moon. China and Russia responded with elegant symmetry. On March 9, 2021, they signed their own agreement to jointly construct the International Lunar Research Station. 13 nations now follow this parallel legal framework. We now have 2 competing constitutions for a world with no government, 2 incompatible visions for humanity's lunar future, each backed by nuclear powers. But why this sudden urgency? Why transform the moon from a romantic symbol into a geopolitical battlefield? The answer had been locked in ice for billions of years. Between 2008 and 2009, India's Chandrayaan-1 and NASA's LCROSS missions detected something that transformed barren craters into the space equivalent of Saudi oil fields. Water. Not droplets, not traces. Hundreds of billions of kilograms of water ice, concentrated in the moon's permanently shadowed polar regions, places where sunlight hasn't touched the ground since before life emerged on Earth. Water means drinking. Water means oxygen for breathing. But most critically, water means hydrogen and oxygen, rocket fuel. The moon had just become a gas station for the solar system, Picture an Olympic swimming pool. Now picture 240,000 of them, filled to the brim. That's the conservative estimate for water ice at the lunar poles. And conservative estimates in space usually prove laughably small. But here's what makes hearts race in Beijing and Washington. This ice isn't spread evenly like butter on toast. It's concentrated in permanently shadowed regions. Cosmic freezers where temperatures plunge to minus 230 degrees Celsius, colder than liquid nitrogen. These aren't vast plains. They're specific craters, particular valleys, countable locations. Whoever controls these spots doesn't just control water. They control whether humanity expands into the solar system or remains trapped in Earth's gravity well. Let me put this in perspective. Launching 1 kilogram of anything from Earth costs roughly $2,000. Launching that same kilogram from the moon, $6. The nation that controls lunar fuel production doesn't just have a competitive advantage. They have a chokehold on humanity's throat. China has abandoned all pretense of pure scientific interest. Official statements from the China National Space Administration explicitly outline lunar mining operations as a national strategic priority. Their Chang'e 7 mission, launching in 2026, will scout the South Pole with ground-penetrating radar designed to map ice deposits down to 100 meters depth. By 2028, Chang'e 8 will test what they call in-situ resource utilization, diplomatic speak for mining equipment. The United States counters with public-private partnerships that blur every line. NASA's Viper rover, if it survives its current budget crisis, carries a 1-meter drill designed by Honeybee Robotics, a company that also makes drilling equipment for Earth's mining industry. SpaceX and Blue Origin, ostensibly transportation companies, have quietly filed patents for lunar excavation equipment. When Elon Musk says he wants to make humanity multiplanetary, he's not speaking metaphorically. He's speaking about controlling the resources that make it possible. But water is just the opening bid. Helium-3, deposited by solar wind over billions of years, could theoretically power fusion reactors. One cargo bay of helium-3 could power the United States for a year. China's lunar program specifically mentions helium-3 extraction in its 2050 roadmap. They're planning for an energy source that doesn't even have working reactors yet. That's how far ahead they're thinking. Here's the crucial detail everyone misses. The 1967 Outer Space Treaty prohibits nations from claiming lunar territory, but it says nothing definitive about commercial extraction. It's the difference between claiming you own the river and claiming you own the water you've bucketed out. The first nation to successfully extract and use lunar resources doesn't technically violate any treaty, but they establish the precedent for how extraction works. As space lawyer Laura Montgomery testified to Congress, possession may not be 9/10 of the law in space, but operational capability certainly influences legal interpretation translation. Whoever starts mining first writes the rules for everyone who follows. Every 3 hours, something passes over the moon that officially doesn't exist. The US Space Force, a military branch that sounds like science fiction but commands a $30 billion budget, established the 19th Space Defense Squadron in 2024 with a classified mission described only as cislunar space domain awareness. Military personnel don't use words like awareness unless they mean surveillance, and they don't create entire squadrons unless they're watching something worth watching. Consider the X-37B, Boeing's robotic space plane that looks like a miniature space shuttle crossed with a stealth bomber. It has spent over 4,200 days in space across 7 missions, carrying classified payloads that the Pentagon refuses to discuss even in closed congressional sessions. Its 8th mission, launched in August 2025, tests something called quantum navigation systems, technology that would allow spacecraft to operate in complete radio silence, invisible to conventional tracking. The X-37B's orbit takes it far higher than the International Space Station, high enough to reach the moon in 3 days. When asked directly whether the spacecraft conducts lunar reconnaissance, Space Force officials respond with the phrase, "I can neither confirm nor deny," which in military speak means, "Absolutely yes, but I'd go to prison for saying so." China's surveillance infrastructure makes no attempt at subterfuge. The Queqiao relay satellite doesn't just communicate with Chang'e 4, it provides persistent observation of the entire lunar far side. When NASA's Artemis missions land, China will watch every moment through a telescope no American instrument can match. They've turned the moon's natural radio shadow into an intelligence advantage. But the real revelation comes from analyzing orbital patterns. A data scientist in Amsterdam, working with publicly available tracking data, noticed something odd. Several recent communication satellites from multiple nations have orbital characteristics that make no sense for communication, but perfect sense for surveillance. Their orbits create what she calls lunar observation bells, allowing continuous monitoring of specific lunar latitudes. These satellites, officially launched for technology demonstration, carry suspicious amounts of extra fuel and unexplained mass that matches military-grade optical equipment. Every nation participating in this shadow war faces the same dilemma. How do you hide your activities on a world with no atmosphere, where footprints last forever, and where every landing creates a plume visible from Earth orbit? The answer is you don't hide. You simply classify everything and dare others to call you out. The dual-use nature of space technology makes this shell game possible. A laser communication system can transmit data or blind enemy sensors. A navigation beacon can guide friendly spacecraft or jam hostile ones. A sample return drill can collect scientific specimens or destroy a rival's equipment. In the vacuum of space, every tool is potentially a weapon. And every weapon can be called a tool. Here's the question that keeps strategists awake. How do you defend territory you can't legally claim on a world where a throne rock becomes a permanent projectile? The Outer Space Treaty prohibits weapons of mass destruction in space, but says nothing about conventional weapons. It's a loophole large enough to fly a military spacecraft through, which is exactly what's happening. Budget documents from the US Space Force, though heavily redacted, reveal a line item called Cislunar Highway Patrol System. The name sounds almost quaint until you realize patrol implies the ability to interdict, and highway suggests someone decides who gets to travel. A leaked Mitchell Institute report recommended an additional $250 million per year and 200 new Space Force personnel specifically for lunar operations. The unclassified justification mentions protecting American and allied assets. The classified annex, according to sources, discusses rapid response capabilities and area denial systems, military euphemisms for weapons. China's approach abandons even the pretense of separation. Their military-civil fusion doctrine, encoded in law since 2015, explicitly states that all space assets serve dual purposes. The rover that analyzes lunar soil can also analyze a competitor's landing site. The communication relay that serves scientific missions can also coordinate military operations. As Chinese defense papers state with remarkable candor, control of space determines control of Earth. The safety zones concept reveals how conflict might actually unfold. The Artemis Accords allow nations to establish these zones around operations, ostensibly to prevent interference. But imagine this scenario. The United States establishes a safety zone around a water-rich crater. China lands nearby, claiming their own scientific preservation zone. Neither acknowledges the other zone. Both claim the other is violating international norms. Who enforces the boundaries? Who decides the dispute? The answer is nobody. And that's the problem. Recent tests of debris removal technology by both nations add another dimension of concern. These systems, designed to clean up space junk, can grab, move, or deorbit spacecraft. The same robotic arm that removes a dead satellite can disable a living one. The same laser that vaporizes debris can blind sensors. China's Shijian series has demonstrated the ability to approach within meters of other satellites, grapple them, and change their orbits, capabilities with obvious military applications. The race to establish permanent bases accelerates this defensive paranoia. Both Artemis Base Camp and the International Lunar Research Station target the 2030s for initial operations, with construction potentially beginning by 2028. Once established, these bases create what military planners call facts on the ground, or in this case, facts on the regolith. Removing an established base would require either diplomatic pressure Earthside or direct action Moonside, either of which could spiral into broader conflict. Step back and see the full picture. What began as humanity's greatest adventure, footprints and flags, golf balls and poetry, has become a high-stakes chess game where the board itself is the prize. China's far-side surveillance through Chang'e 4 and Queqiao. The Artemis Accords and ILRS carving the moon into rival spheres. Water ice turning lifeless craters into economic gold mines. The Space Force's secret patrols. Dual-use technologies blurring the line between science and war. These aren't isolated events. They're coordinated moves in a single unfolding game. The next 5 years will decide whether the moon remains humanity's shared inheritance or fractures into contested territories drawn in vacuum. NASA's Artemis 3 and China's planned crewed landing both target the South Pole before 2030. The nation that builds the first permanent base won't own the moon, but they'll shape the rules for everyone else. In the silence of space, the competition has already begun. Budgets, treaties, rockets, and robots are the weapons. The infrastructure rising today, the satellites, the laws, the safety zones, will determine whether the moon becomes a symbol of cooperation or a front line of conflict. Tomorrow's history is being written now, in launch manifests and conference rooms from Washington to Beijing. The shadow war for lunar control isn't science fiction. It's our future unfolding in real time. And unlike the space race of the 1960s, this time the winners won't just plant a flag and come home. This time, they'll stay. If you enjoyed this story, hit subscribe for more stories where history, technology, and human ambition collide. Thanks for watching.